Welcome everybody to our workshop. As you can see, our numbers are small today, but I'm sure that means that we're going to be very high on quality. Some of you are here today because you were involved in the action research, the mini action research project last year, and you're coming to be advisors for this year. Some of you are coming for the first time, so we welcome, and some of you may join the program, some of you may not join the program. That's all fine, we just welcome everyone. So I just thought we'd start with first each one of you introducing just your name and your department, perhaps just so you all know each other. So starting from here.
Greg from Economics.
Vivian from Applied Psychology.
John from Science.
And Mark from the Science Unit.
Maureen from the Department of Management.
Mark from SEAL.
Austin, also from SEAL.
Thank you. Yes, and there may be one or two others coming in as well. My co-presenter is Preet Harita, Professor Preet Harita, and she's an assistant professor in the English department. In the last triennium, she was the recipient of a large-scale grant from the CAOBE to do an action research project, which she will tell you a little bit about later. And her and I'm Julie Groves, the manager of the CAOBE, most of you know me. Last year, Preet and I, plus four of the people here, worked together on the MARP, the Mini Action Research Project, as well. And I just wanted to make you aware of the... Where am I? The CAOB awards, which are given, hopefully, every year. And yes, I think most of you have already seen these. These are the awards for the last 2 years. I just thought it was very interesting that, in fact, over the last 2 years, most of these awards have been given to the MARP consultants who are here today, and Professor Preet has won both years, as there have been other projects as well. But I just thought it was very interesting that this project has led to a lot of awards being granted. Okay, now before continuing, I'd like to let you know of some resources. Again, most of you already know these resources, but there are a few here that may not. Firstly, we have our book repository in the back there, which you're welcome to look at later. And we have categories, like there's one whole section on action research, one whole section on rubrics, one whole section on OBE in general, and another section on teaching practice, and so on. And you can go to the CAOBE site for more details, which you have on your, let's carry this with me. I've given you this mainly because it's got the website address on it, because this you will find, everything to do with the CAOBE you will find on here. Okay. I did want to draw to your attention one page on the CAOBE site, that's the resources page. On the resources page, there are three fairly major or important resources here. The first one is the guidebook on plagiarism, and that's this one, which most of you, again, should already have seen or should already have got a copy of. This is the hard copy. There's more available over there. If you don't have one, please take one. And here online, we have the soft copy that you can download instead. Then we have our Lingnan book repository, which is this one over here, which is normally in my office. And if you want to find out more about it, you can go online and you can actually read, see all the books and read about them and decide what you want to do. And you can even order by emailing me. You don't even have to come and look at them if you don't want to. Okay. And then finally, our online OBE repository, which again, most of you have seen. We're working on this and it's getting bigger and bigger all the time, but I just want to highlight two resources to you that are very important in Lingnan at the moment. That is to do with plagiarism and rubrics. So on the best practice page, we have a whole section on rubrics. So you can read about rubrics in general, like the rationale behind rubrics, how to write them, when to use them, and so on. And there's many, many sample rubrics. For instance, for specific tasks or skills. So, for instance, here, leadership, leading skills rubrics. You can download rubrics from different people here, and we're hoping that this will eventually expand and become very big, even bigger. Then we also have the plagiarism section, dealing with plagiarism. So you might find something there if you're finding that's a problem or an issue in your class. Okay, so go back to the PowerPoint. Okay. Now, for today's program, we have a bit of an ambitious schedule because we're originally hoping in 1 hour we can do the teaching part of the workshop, teaching an interactive part of the workshop, telling you about action research, also talking a little bit about Preet's project and describing what action research or action learning techniques are, and then introducing you to the Total Teacher Program. Then we've put 12:40 to 1 for lunch and sign-up time. We will be bringing a lunch in here and sharing it here, and just whatever time we finish, we'll get to lunch. During that time, you'll have some time to sign up. There'll be a sign-up sheet over there. If you're a new person, you'd like to join the program, you can sign up there. So we'll give you like 10, 15 minutes to start eating your lunch. And then those that are going to be involved in the Total Teacher Program will come back to your tables, and we will have, or come back around one table, and we will have a brief meeting with those interested Total Teachers, and we can answer more questions and give you specifically what you have to do first and second and so on, so you can get into the program. Okay, all clear? Right. Now, this is an interactive workshop, so we're going to start with a question. And you're all in... Oh, Carol, you're by yourself. Or maybe... Yeah, that's good. Thank you. Okay, the question. What kinds of things do you do as a teacher to ensure that students are comprehending what you're teaching and achieving the learning outcomes on a class-by-class basis? So you've got 1, 2, 3 small groups. Discuss this for a couple of minutes in your small groups, and then we'll get some feedback. I can hear lots and lots of good conversation going on.
If I learn them, I can...
Can we just go around, say, table by table, and each table at first just give me one idea that's different to the other table. So this table, one idea, one thing.
Worksheet. I usually give out worksheets for the students to do, mm-hmm. and that can test them, right? Mm-hmm. Maybe a case, maybe some short questions.
Okay, thank you. And one idea from this table?
Asking questions.
During the class.
Yeah, no, we were just talking about, often in class you might ask them if they have any questions. Mm. And then Mark was saying, you know, that when they don't respond or they say they don't, then he assumes he's the best teacher. But I was saying that if you ask them questions then about what they don't have questions about,
then you really find out if...
Right, if they have, really do understand what you're talking about.
Okay, one idea from this
review. It may be similar to what Maureen said, but I give a weekly quiz at the beginning of nearly every lecture. It's 10 minutes, it's a question concerning material from the previous week. I allow them to use their lecture notes, I allow them to use the book, but if they wish to search online, I say that's fine, I only tell them I don't want you to chat with other people, because then maybe someone's just copying. Of course, I cannot monitor, maybe they are texting. So that is something I must accept. Sometimes students say it's too much work, but I think if I take away 10 minutes of me talking, that they, where they have to be there anyway, it's not a large burden.
Okay, thank you. Right, well, this is basically what we've been talking about is what the Total Teacher Program is all about. It's trying to find out whether the students are learning or not through using action learning techniques. We've got action learning here. Action learning is pretty much the same as action research. It's just that putting action learning made the acronym TOTAL much better than putting in TOTAL research. Yep. Also, it shows that this is a learning process for both the teachers and the students when you're engaging in action learning. Okay, so the outcome for today's lesson, for today's workshop, is that you can apply action learning techniques to enhance student learning outcomes in your classes. That's it in a nutshell. Okay. Now, we'll go on to what is action learning or action research. It's a planned, systematic approach to understanding the learning processes of our own students. There's two important parts to this. The first part is that it's systematic, which is the difference between normal teaching and tips it over to being a kind of educational research. And then the focus is on learning processes of students. So this relates directly to an outcomes-based system because it enables us to help our students better achieve the intended learning outcomes. Action learning is also a cyclical process of systematic collection of information followed by active reflection leading to action taken on that reflection. Reflection, both on behalf of students and teachers, is at the core of action research. Now, I gave this example at the last workshop, which some of you may remember, and in Biggs and Tang, Professor Biggs' book and Tang, they talk about two teacher trainees, Robert and Susan, who have graduated and both got work. So Robert, he's a surface thinker. He likes to do the least amount of work as possible, that kind of student. But Susan is a deep thinker. So after they have been both teaching for 20 years, Susan has had 20 years of teaching experience. Robert has had 1 year of teaching experience, repeated 19 times, right? So the principle here is that we can never truly master our professions to the point where we can just simply keep doing what we're doing year after year the same. Like our students, we are also to be lifelong learners, and reflection with constant adjustment is a part of this. Now, why should we do it? Well, firstly, the main reason is because it improves the teaching and learning in our classrooms, which is what we're all about. It gives us greater understanding of the situation, all the students, all the problems. It can answer long-standing questions we might have, and it can also identify problems that we didn't even realise were there or might not have noticed. Also, reflective practice is the foundation for true school improvement, because any system or form of pedagogy it cannot be truly implemented or fine-tuned well without teachers at the ground level reflectively and thoughtfully applying it and adapting it. It helps teachers to research unique local situations, because most of the educational research literature is kind of very general, but it may not apply specifically to your local context. So that's a strength in doing individual action research. It gives teachers opportunity to follow an area of your own interest and do it as a kind of research. So you can say, in that sense, it customises professional development opportunities. It connects research with teaching, because at one end it requires us to test our ideas about education, and at the other end it can justify and fine-tune our own teaching practices. Also, it's a very effective form of professional development. Because as you're doing it, it's an important part of determining what your professional development needs are, as well as being a form of professional development in itself. It improves our professional judgment and it gives us insight into better and more effective means of achieving desirable educational outcomes. Now, how it differs from other programs offered by the TLC. We have an end of semester CTLE, and the difference there is that this is summative only. CTLE is summative only at the end of the semester. It's only given feedback on the course and teacher as a whole, and it doesn't benefit those students who are giving the feedback. It may or may not. It may not even benefit the next year of teachers, depending on whether the teacher makes any changes on it or not. An online CTLE is one step further, because it enables you to do a course teaching learning tool during the semester, so you can find out things if you want to. But again, action research, it involves cycles of research rather than just like a one-time inquiry. Peer observation and faculty mentoring are two programs we'd like to promote more. But these rely on classroom observations by peers. And there's no direct student feedback. As in action research, there's direct student feedback. The student consultant program, I often get asked, what's the difference between the student consultant program and like the MART or the total teacher program? This is another program we'd like to promote, but this involves observation and reflection, mostly by a student consultant. So the difference is that you have a student consultant in the classroom partnering with a teacher. With action research, it's the teacher himself that gathers feedback directly from the students in a more systematic way. And it's the teacher's responsibility then to reflect on what is on his or her teaching. So in short, all these are programs designed to help you learn about and improve your own teaching. But action research is not really a program in itself, but it's a tool. It's a tool to help you with your teaching. However, we've made it into a program and called it the Total Teaching Program in order to help you learn to use this tool. And so if you know the principles, you can customize this tool to your own situation. You can collaborate with others or do it by yourself. It's a very flexible tool. Once you've learned and you have mastered the principles, you can then apply it in the future to any of your classes. It's not just a one semester only. And it can also lead very quickly to more radical and noticeable changes in the classroom and the materials. As Preet will now explain, she will talk about action research and practice.
Okay, so thanks, Julie. Yeah, thanks. So what Julie talked about was the principles of action research, and what I'm going to share with you is a more practical aspect of it. And I'll share that with a project that I did 2 years ago. And I'll give some examples also from the pilot project that we did last year to get a more practicable sense of what exactly action research is. So it's essentially like what Julie says, it's a qualitative approach for investigating students' learning practices, processes of learning for achieving intended learning outcomes, maximizing opportunities of effective learning practices through ongoing reflection and action for improvement. What do we mean by this? We did a project for a course that we teach on a language enhancement course, and we at Lingnan, we are more or less good with understanding of outcomes. We already have all the courses which are kind of aligned where the outcomes and the assessments map onto each other. We know that, say for example, outcome 1, 2, 3 is going to be assessed by assignment 1, outcomes 4 and 5 are going to be assessed by assignment number 3, or so on and so forth. Now what happens in between, we don't know whether students are actually achieving those outcomes in any way. So the best way to do that is to find it out in a more systematic way. And that's where action learning comes into being. So what we do is, what we did for the project is, like what you do in essentially in action research is, you observe your classrooms, you kind of collect feedback on how students are learning or what students are facing as problems. You try to address those problems in different ways, and then you again try and reflect on that and see if that action that you took based on addressing those problems work or not. So we did it through classroom observations, through reflective journals, through interviews with students, and through different kind of evidences that we collected. So the conceptual framework, now any teacher who normally teaches subconsciously goes through these phases, or consciously goes through these phases. So any teaching and learning process will have at least these phases. So when a teacher is teaching, he or she tries to understand whether what he or she is teaching is really being understood by the students or not. So understanding the students' learning processes or their problems. The teacher also tries to see that, okay, if my students are facing some problems, I must address them in some way. Not that we can address each and every problem, but we try to do it subconsciously. We see that, okay, if this particular topic or this particular method did not work, how can I change it and make it better? And how can I make it more easy for my students to understand? So I observe. So as a teacher, you may end up implementing some kind of an action, and you may observe whether that action has worked or not. And finally, you kind of reflect on that and say, ah, maybe I did this particular thing and that's why my students are able to work on it, or students are able to understand it. Now, this is a normal teaching and learning process. Anyone, any good teacher would do this, right? What action research does is it systematically organizes these phases into a cycle, into a spiral. So action research is essentially helping you to systematically put all these or manifest these stages into a more concrete, practicable manner. So there are four stages in any action research cycle, there are four stages. Stage one is the planning. Planning is where you kind of decide, okay, I know my students are not able to understand this concept, but how do I find out what exactly my students are going through? So I kind of plan by either getting someone to come and observe the class, or I kind of meet my students after the class and ask them to have a one-on-one discussion with them, whether they actually understood the topic or so on and so forth. Or maybe I give them at the end of the class a kind of a mini questionnaire, a reflective questionnaire where they found where. So this is like the planning stage is where you collect feedback from students in a more systematic approach. After you have collected that, what you do is you take, you read it, of course, or you understand it, you process it, and you say, my students have written that, they are really struggling with this aspect, or this particular student, when he or she came and told me something, she really can't understand. So how can I, as a teacher, better this? So next time when I'm teaching this particular topic, or not the same topic, but let's say this outcome, how do I change either the methodology, or I bring in some new material, or maybe I change the way I present the material in the class, or maybe I create some kind of an activity. So what I do is, as a teacher, I kind of do the action. So the second stage of any action research cycle is taking an action in order to address the problems that have been highlighted in the first stage of the cycle. Having said that, the next stage is the observing stage, where after I have changed that technique or that strategy of teaching that particular outcome, or let's say I created a new task or activity in the class, I observe again as a teacher whether this technique worked or not, and I kind of reflect on it. Now, this does not stop here. So what action research does is, it is a kind of a spiral. Now, after reflecting, again you go through another stage of whether students are able to achieve that outcome, what are they doing when they are facing that when they are faced with that particular situation where they have to produce, let's say, some kind of a text. Again, I take another action, observe, reflect, and this keeps going on. So action research is essentially four stages: planning, action, observing, and reflecting. And going back to planning, action, observing, and reflecting. So before we move on, let's do a little activity with everyone. So think about that you've already taught, most of you have a lot of experience in teaching. So in the context of your courses that you teach, what problems do students face, right, in relation to the outcomes of your courses? Not just general problems, but we're talking about achieving of outcomes. You can think of them in three ways, in these three areas. Like, my students are not able to understand concepts, or say, for example, my students probably understand the concepts, but when it comes to applying those concepts, they're not able to apply them. Or, they understand it, they comprehend it, probably they're able to apply it, but there is some kind of a problem in the way they express it or the way they produce that. So can you spend 5 minutes on discussing amongst yourselves what exactly, what kind of problems your students face, and share amongst yourselves? Okay, all right, so we have some interesting observations in the groups. So I see that some of you, I think at least the two groups that I visited, I realized that understanding is not that much of a problem. Probably it's when it comes to application or production, probably it comes as a problem. But all of this, how do we know? How do we find this out? One is through the assessments, right? But that's the end. I mean, after that, they get a grade and that's it, right? How do we make sure that students are able to apply those concepts? So how do we make sure that students are able to express themselves well? Or how do we find out whether, first of all, there is a problem over here? So a systematic way of doing that is, like, this is all we are presuming or we are assuming or we think intuitively, all right, that, oh, probably this is where the students are struggling. If you want to find out systematically, we have to use some kind of tools to find out where the problems lie with the students when they are learning anything. And for the project that which I did, I used three tools, which are, of course, technically five, actually, because it was a big project. So we used classroom observation notes. So we had someone come and observe classes for the teachers and write detailed notes about how the students are responding in the class or what the teacher is doing and so on and so forth. At the end of each class, so this is after the planning has already taken place. So there was a team, the team consisted of two more teachers along with me. And at the beginning, at the planning stage, that's year, that's stage number one, we sat down and we decided, okay, let's work in week number three, okay, where we are doing outcome number, blah, 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 all right? And we know that students are really struggling with this, more or less, but let's find out if they're where exactly they're struggling with it. So we had classroom observations taking place. At the end of the lessons, we would get students to fill in reflective journals. And those reflective journals are very, not very detailed. They're very, very, very pointed, with very pointed questions. And these reflective journals are also filled in by the teacher. So at the end of the class, it's not only the students who are filling in the journal, but it's also the teacher who's filling in this journal. And after the reflection, you have the assistant who comes and interviews the students and see whatever they have said in the reflective journals, what exactly they mean by that. So probably when they talk in the interview, they are able to elaborate on what they said in their reflective journals. And these interviews also were done with teachers. So do they have a sheet of the feedback techniques? Okay, all right. So you, what I'd like you all to do is, so these were the three tools that we used: classroom observation, reflective journals, and focus group interviews. Now, as an individual teacher, you may not get like a research assistant to work with you, but you may still want to address the student's problem. How do you do that? So what kind of feedback techniques or feedback gathering techniques would you use in the light of the problems that you thought about in the first activity? And how will you implement them in your class? Now, this means that you don't have to have interviews. It's not necessary that every time you have to do classroom observations. You can do reflective journals, but there is a list of other techniques that you can do as well. So in the light of the problems that you perceive for your courses, how will you implement any of these techniques, or which techniques would you implement to find out whether these problems exist or not? Okay, so you may go through them and share amongst your groups. Okay.
Once you truly understand it, if you can take a
okay, so. All right. Okay. So can we just quickly have a view of what kind of feedback techniques do you think would be applicable to your classes?
We just talked about the minute paper.
The minute paper, all right, yeah.
Just taking some time to, we were talking about, should we do it at the end of the class or the next class after?
Right.
This is what we were talking about. But regardless of, you know, when you do it, this is something that doesn't take so much time, and you can really, you'll know right away what the problems are.
Mm, yeah. How about, yeah, that's a good one.
I think from our group, one of the things we talked about, you know, that came from the people who participated last year was the value of getting student feedback.
Right.
Having them say what they're thinking.
Yes.
Was so valuable compared to seeing, I know there's a problem, I can see there's a problem, I see you look confused.
Yes.
That doesn't help me solve it, but...
But at least it's highlighting it. Yeah, it's becoming aware of it, yes.
Oh, I never even would have thought of that.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
But also because it was anonymous, they felt more comfortable writing, and there was no way to get back. You know, if you had 20 or 40 or 60 students,
right,
and you had 20 highlighting one area...
Clearly you know that, right,
then,
this is,
then,
a, there
then,
is
then
a...
Something
I need to do something about it, right.
Right,
yeah, yeah, oh great, yeah. Yes,
I was thinking about the reflective journal, but usually I did it at the end of the course.
At the end of the course, all right, yes,
now
okay.
I'm thinking about doing it more often.
Yes, like an ongoing reflection,
and,
yeah.
And more focus on the topic or the content.
Yes.
Instead of
yeah, exactly. So this is exactly what we did in the MART project, where, and we have some two very enthusiastic participants from there. So what you can see on your left is we had a student feedback form. So we collected, or we were becoming aware of our students' problems through these three tools. One is through the student's feedback form, which it's kind of a reflective journal, a teacher reflection, where the teacher was also writing down how he or she felt that particular class was, and working in groups and sharing those problems with your team members. So what happened in that is, like, as a result of the sharing, so many things came to light, and that really helped in, and some of the people were actually helping them out, saying that, oh, maybe you could addresses this problem, or some teachers felt that, oh, your class does the same, or even mine does the same. So you, it helped you to become aware that these are the areas in which students have problems. This is what we'd be doing even in the teacher, the total teacher program, where we'd be looking at feedback from students, we'll be reflecting on our teaching, as well as we'll be sharing amongst the team members what exactly our students' problems are and what potential actions we could take to address those problems. Okay? Yes. Okay, yeah. So Julie is handing out the teacher reflection form for you to take a look at. And it's a very simplistic form, but it's very potent in a way, because it really helps you highlight a lot of things as a teacher as well. Again, it's all about systematic, organized, structured reflection, right? So ongoing reflection and action. So again, coming back to the project that we did, that is, I did for my particular course with a team of other teachers. The course was Varieties of English. Of course, it was a big project, so we kind of looked at every outcome, and we tried to address every outcome in the course. But I'm just giving an example of one particular outcome, which talked about analyzing structural, linguistic, and non-linguistic features of texts and relate them to the context and purposes. So basically, what students are required to do is they are supposed to look at a text and analyze it. And as part of the, after doing this, we have students giving feedback, like, so we did it in two phases for the same outcome. So students said things like, oh, the most difficult point I encountered was the analysis of a proposal. And in the interview, again, the student is saying the same thing, is saying a longer sentence, but we just take the most important part, and she says, oh, the task is so confusing. And this was not just one student saying it, but a lot of other students were saying it. So clearly the teacher was immediately aware of this, and she's like, oh, okay, I need to do something about this, because my students are not able to analyze the text, or they're not able to understand different features of the text. What do I do to do help them to do this? So what she did is, this is her action that she took. That is, after observing, after she gets the feedback, she takes some action. What she does is, she divides the class into small groups, and she assigns each member in the group that you will look at this part of the text, you will look at this part of the text, you will look at it, and each of you will present your part of the text in your group. Okay, so then, and then she tries to see whether the students have understood the text. So she's kind of broken it down into different ways. In the next phase, again, this action, now students have noticed that, yes, if we work amongst ourselves in this way, we are able to understand the concept even better. So they say, oh, this is an interesting lesson. Now we can cooperate with each other, right? And they say that, I have understood all the techniques and the points covered in the class. So now the teacher realizes that, oh, okay, if I do this kind of a technique, if I change, rather than just handing out a sheet and saying, okay, analyze this text, use these methods, I can do it in a different way. And then now this time she takes it one step ahead. So she says, okay, don't sit with your friends. So she organizes them in different abilities of groups. And then she says, okay, discuss amongst yourselves, share your analysis, and now you will present in front of the class. So now this, she's taking this, she's using the same technique, but she's taking it a step further, all right? And she's getting them to present it inside the class, in front of everyone. So what happens is, oh, where's the picture? All right, okay. So what happens is, just miraculously disappeared. So students are able to now, when they are reflecting in this part, when you see the reflective forms, the reflective journals, you see that, oh, this technique really works. And now they are able to understand it better. Now, students may say this, how do we know whether that's translated in the real assignment? Because ultimately, it's the assignment that matters, right? So we also looked at, so that's very important. So in addition to the reflective journals from the students and the teachers and the sharing, we also need to collect evidences of their work. And that evidences of those work, we could see clearly the difference. So in phase one, when they were really confused and when the task was really confusing or they didn't understand, and if you look at the sample analyses of the text, you can see that they are repetitive, they have no connection between, there's no coherence, there's no cohesion between ideas, they're just repeating themselves over and over again, there's no in-depth analysis. In the phase two, when we see their written work, we actually notice a difference, and we see that now the analyses are more detailed, extensive. They are able to make connections between different parts of the text. Having said that, so we see that through a systematic approach, right, we are able to address the problem, and we can see that even in a in evidences of students' work. So probably when you do your one-minute paper or when you do your quizzes or when you do your... So this is before the assignment. You can see that my action that I'm taking is having some kind of an effect on the students' learning processes. So again amongst yourselves, you can discuss what kind of strategies or actions would you try and implement, okay? So like, for example, in my project, what we did is group learning or cooperative learning, and we tried to do it in a different way. How would you, so in the light of your perceived problems, and let's say you have got, hypothetically, you've got a lot of feedback from students, what kind of strategies would you implement? There are some teaching strategies there in your handout. You can take a look at those and discuss for a few minutes.
Okay, can we see, can we hear what you would like to
Both of us have been using cooperative learning, mm-hmm. case study, presentation, discussion a lot, mm-hmm. and I use project work, mm-hmm. and you also use reflective journals. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm.
Okay.
One thing we just talked about here is if you're going to use like a class resource, like PowerPoint slides, for example, mm-hmm. after reflecting on how the students are interpreting that information,
yeah.
what they're getting out of it and what they're not, adjusting the vocabulary that you're going to mm-hmm. use for that, right, and sort of preemptively giving them sort of a guidebook for how to mm-hmm. digest that information.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I think
we are talking about a reflective journal. How the teacher to enhance the teaching process. Mm. But, I'm sharing my own experience. I'm not a teacher, I used to be a student, mm. and one of my teachers is a very lovely and open-minded teacher. She did the reflective journal, and she actually reflect on it and action on it very quickly. Mm. So she can analyze and summarize the comments from the student, and then find out the main things that we are struggling, and then just adjust the class next week, and then or talk it once again to make sure the student learn the main one of the concept.
Right, yeah. So, yeah, so clearly, the as we know, it's, so I'm going to quote another example from the science course that we did last year, that what Mark already explained. Essentially, what we do in action research is you get feedback from the students, see where the problems are, take an action based on that, and see whether those students really appreciate that action, or does it really affect their learning in any way. So, for example, the student feedback that one of the courses got was, I mean, these are two phases, of course, they are not at the same time. There are too many new terms. I mean, science can be very daunting for our students, so clearly they found it that, oh. So what the teacher does is he adds a pre-lesson vocabulary list, and he provides a brief reading on Moodle, which helps them to distinguish the important terms and essential terms. Of course, Mark will be able to explain more with you to you how exactly he implemented that. And another interesting thing that in the next phase, what the teacher did was he incorporated a modern dance for students to demonstrate the important concepts using space and movement. So this was about tectonic plates, right? Yeah, this was about something on earthquakes and the movement of the tectonic plates. And clearly, theoretically, students were finding it very difficult. So they said, somebody said, oh, we need more hands-on work, and this is what the teacher implemented. So it doesn't necessarily have to be, like we said, action research is extremely localized, contextualized. You know best what works with your students. At that moment, you will know as a teacher what exactly I need to adjust and how. Clearly, after the pre-lesson list, students are saying things like, oh, it helped a lot on better understanding of the materials, clearly because they were struggling a lot with the vocabulary in the beginning. And one of the students said, oh, the class was divided into four groups to perform how typhoon forms, and this better, this helped me better understand the concepts. So you can see that the systematic process of ongoing reflection and action and reflecting and acting really helps you become aware of how you can understand student problems and how you can address them and how you can become better reflective teachers. Yeah. So I'll hand it over to Julie to talk about the Total Teacher Program now and see what it entails. Yeah. Okay. Oh, sorry. Yeah.
Okay, so this was the mark from last year, but it's exactly the same as the Total Teacher Program. So these are the kinds of results you could possibly have. There was also another result. The MART project didn't only just change some teaching and learning activities, it also changed some course materials, and also one of the teachers changed his ILOs. Professor Paul Whitley ended up with some fairly major changes in his ILOs. So you can see the first from 2014 to 15. In fact, I think these were the ILOs for several years up to 2014-15. And these were them after he did the MARP, during the MARP process. And you can see the purple here. He realised that the ethical dimension should have its own special ILO with its own verb account for there. He said number three, the green one, apply knowledge gained in other courses. And a quote from him, he said to me, he found that the class activities covered either none of the learning outcomes or it was unclear which of the outcomes they did cover. And so number three, apply, was deleted because he said no TLAs were found to be actually covering this outcome. So it was just deleted. And then number two, the very basic, explain, got upgraded to adapt marketing strategies and recognising the factors. Okay, so there were some significant changes there. Now, we've given you some examples of how research, action research in practice can actually help. Now it's time to answer the question, what is the Total Teacher Program? Firstly, the theory of it. In theory, it's a template that applies action research techniques adapted to an outcomes-based setting in order to help students better attain selected course outcomes. As you've heard, this involves the gathering of structured student feedback as well as focused action-oriented reflection on teaching effectiveness. Now, from the practical point of view, we do this over one semester. It's a one semester program, and it takes around, according to the previous MARP consultants, it takes only around 10 to 16 hours extra during the semester, which is not bad considering the outcomes that you can achieve from it. And again, teachers will be paid $4,000 for successful completion of the program. Now, in practice, in steps, the steps in the total teacher program, it's very, very focused. So you take one class and you choose one section of that class. Then, in that class, you choose one of your ILOs to investigate, just one, and you focus on that one. Then, you take 4 weeks only out of the whole semester where you're going to where you know that you're teaching on that ILO. And those 4 weeks will then be split into 2 times 2 weeks, which will be 2 phases for action research, 2 cycles. Then for each cycle, you will need to be doing a kind of triangulation. So every week you'll be collecting student feedback. We've talked about the student feedback forms. Last year we actually had student helpers collecting student feedback forms, but this year we've gone one step better and we're now doing it, it's available to be done online, on the online CTLE. We have added an extra section to the online CTLE. And so now I'd like to show you how you can access this, because even if you don't sign up for the program, you're welcome to use these for this class, for your own classes. So I'll give you a handout later that will give you the steps to this, but just now I'll just do it very quickly to show you the questions. So we create a survey. Go to next. We won't fill in all that stuff right now. Go to next. And then you'll find down here, select question from question bank. And the question bank, the first one is action research questions. And I don't know why we have to select additional here, but we do. And then you'll find we've got about 14 or 15 action research questions, which are very similar to the ones that we did in the MARP last year. The first one and two you'll notice are which learning outcomes were being taught. This should be today, we should delete this week, I need to change that. Or which learning outcome was being taught this week. And in the Total Teacher Project, this will be the first question that we'll get you to ask. So this is kind of like a mandatory one for the Total Teacher Program. Then you can choose 2 or 3 other questions as well. So it's very easy to use this, and there are instructions also as to how to actually get, like you push a button, and the system will collate the results, and you can get the results back without having to actually do all that manual collation yourself. So we don't need student helpers this year. Okay, so you'll be collecting student feedback weekly. You'll also write a teacher reflection after each class. That's just for these 4 weeks, not the whole semester. Then, in 2 cycles, you should have 2 tasks, like Preet said, as evidence to show what the students are actually saying, whether their feedback is actually lining up with what they're doing. So either you can match that with your schedule, if you've got assignments already coming up, we'll just create some kind of mini task. Then you plan action changes for the next cycle, and you repeat again. And we just do 2 cycles. One semester we just do 2 cycles. And in between the cycles, we'll put you into cross-disciplinary groups for sharing ideas and advice, just like we're doing now. So, you don't have the benefit of having your student feedback and your course, in your materials and everything. You will have the benefit then. So I know the MARP teachers last year felt this was a very valuable part of the course. Right. So one last thing. If you are interested in more in action research, we've got kind of an Action Research for Dummies resource here, which is available online, and we've also got hard copies. I know some of you have already got this. These ones here. But if you haven't got one of these, I'll just leave them on the table, so come and grab one if you'd like a hard copy, okay? I can't walk. I'll leave that. Okay, now, basically it's time for... I think we won't take questions and answers because we're going to have a meeting after a brief spot of eating, and the questions and answers will probably come up then. So what we're going to do is... actually, Angel, could you just let her know that we're ready for the lunch? Yeah, thanks. Yep, so the lunch will be over there. We'll give you, what is the time now? Yeah, 10 to 15 minutes maybe to have lunch. Then we'd like you to come back in. I know, but you don't have to finish your lunch. You can bring your lunch back to the table, okay? And then we can have the meeting while you're still eating your lunch. So don't worry about that, okay? So if possible, could the advisors also stay, if that's possible, for the meeting? And if you're interested in joining the program, if you know you want to join the program or you're still not sure but you're interested, come and join the meeting anyway, because then you'll still find out more about it. Okay.